Good evening, delegates attending the Conference on Agricultural Trade and the Development of the Local Food Economy in Africa. My name is Diana Akullo from the African Union Commission. I would like to first of all apologize for not being able to join you in this meeting. I was looking forward to having very fruitful discussions with all of you, but due to circumstances beyond me, I was not able to join you in this particular meeting. So please accept the recording of my discussion I was going to have with you. Now, before I launch into my presentation, let me first of all take you through what the African Union Commission does. Firstly, the Commission is responsible for supporting the 54 member countries of the African Union in developing policies that are necessary but do not exist, and where they exist but require that they be harmonized for the different member countries to be able to work with each other. The Commission also supports implementation of priority programs for the continent and also supports the resource mobilization for implementing the identified priority programs. Last but not least, the Commission also undertakes advocacy for key issues affecting the continent, mostly socioeconomic issues that need to be brought to the fore of all the member countries. Now, before I launch into what the African Union position on agricultural trade is, let me first of all share with you some of the factors that underlie the position of the African Union. Firstly, the rapid growth of the intra-African agri-food market, which has been fueled by the high population growth. As you may be aware, Africa has one of the youngest populations in the world. And also we have very rapid urbanization and income growth. We have a number of middle-income earners who have now sprouted all over the continent. So that has meant that intra-African food demand will continue to increase. In fact, a study by the World Bank shows that by 2050, the demand for food within the African continent will rise by 178%. Again, according to the World Bank, there has been tremendous increase in the Africa's net food import bill over the years. And this import bill has been recorded at an annual figure of $40 billion. And this is projected to increase or reach $400 billion per year by 2030. Now, another factor that also underlies Africa Union's position on agricultural trade is the need for African agriculture to undergo a structural transformation to meet the rising food demands within the continent. Now, there are two issues, two key decisions that are pertinent to agricultural trade currently in Africa. One, you will have heard that recently the African Union member countries signed the Continental Free Trade Area Agreement, simply known as the CFTA. This was signed on the 21st of March in Kigali, Rwanda. Now, another factor, that one is specifically aimed at addressing the trade angle. In terms of production, in 2014, the African Union heads of state and government also adopted what we currently know as the Malabo Declaration on Accelerated Agricultural Growth and Transformation for Shared Prosperity and Improved Livelihoods. Now, the leaders potentially committed themselves, among others, to boosting intra-Africa trade in agricultural goods and services with the ambitious target of tripling this trade by 2025. Now, in achieving this commitment, it calls for broader and deeper continental level integration of the intra-African agri-food market. That's why both the CFTA and the Malabo Declaration and the commitment of boosting intra-Africa trade go hand in hand. And this is what informs African Union trade, agricultural trade decisions and positions. Now, Malabo Declaration builds on the successes and lessons learned from 10 years of implementing the Maputo Declaration on the Comprehensive Africa Agriculture Development Program, which is simply also known as CADAP. CADAP was designed to help African countries reach a higher path of economic growth through agriculture-led development, and also at the same time looking into issues of eliminating hunger, ensuring food security within the continent. As you may be aware, Africa is very rich in very many resources, but the paradox is also that it also remains one of the most vulnerable continents in the world. Now, what are the objectives of the CFTA? I'll just go to them through them briefly. One is to enhance competitiveness at all levels of the sectors of agriculture and other trade areas. Two is to overcome the dependence of Africa on exportation of primary products. The third one is also to resolve the challenge of multiple and overlapping membership in regional economic blockings. In Africa, we have about eight regional economic communities. Different member countries belong to different regional economic communities. Now, some countries belong to one or two regional economic blockings. So with the coming in of the CFTA, it's hoped that the issues of multiple membership within economic blocks can be resolved. The CFTA is also aimed at increasing by 50% trade among African countries by 2022. It sounds ambitious, but it's work in progress, and the different member states are striding and working diligently towards achieving this target. The CFTA also aims to create a freer markets for goods and services within the African countries. Now, if you delve deeper into looking at what underlies the CFTA and boosting the intra-African agenda, it's based on one key objective of realizing Agenda 2063. Agenda 2063 is the vision of a transformed and prosperous continent that our leaders came up with in 2013 when the African Union commemorated 50 years of its existence. So CFTA, or the Continental Free Trade Area Program, is a flagship project of Agenda 2063, which will result into one market, one African market. And another underlying factor of the CFTA is that there is also need for Africa to secure its own interests through priority focus of boosting intra-Africa trade. If you look at the recent developments within the global context, for example, Brexit, what was underlying Brexit? It's a move towards this nationalism. We have seen it with the new presidents of the U.S., which is looking at the interests of Africans first. So in that regard, the African leaders also feel that it's high time that they prioritize their trade, their agricultural trade, and other trade in other commodities by looking at the market that is available within the continent. The majority of Africa's population engages in agricultural production, processing, and trade, as well as services. Over 70% is engaged in the agricultural sector. So the CFTA is seen as an engine of making sure that the majority of the population engaged in agricultural sector and gains from agricultural trade one way or the other. Because sometimes you will have lack of a particular commodity within one region of Africa, and then an excess in another area. So how can we make sure that we ensure that we are able to meet various demands? Where there is lack, we ensure that the excess in one area can be exported to the area that needs it. And then we already have some of the positive examples that CFTA draws from. For example, Ghana is increasingly exporting chocolate and cocoa-containing products to the rest of West Africa, and even far beyond beyond West Africa, not only other African countries, but to even Europe and to the Americas. And also there's the move towards the development of the value chains in the production of clothing and textiles from cotton grown in Benin, Burkina Faso, Chad, Uganda. You now see that there is growth. There is that element of local production within the country from which cotton is produced. Another example is Ethiopia. Ethiopia has been exporting shoes to the rest of the East African community with a market valued at over 5 million. And this is a figure that was drawn from 2015. And there are also strong prospects that this market for Ethiopia will keep growing of the leather products. With those examples, we feel that the CFTA can really succeed as one of the vision or position of Africa in advancing agricultural trade. Now, I will conclude with a couple of issues. One, it's important that Africa harnesses the demographic dividends that is currently available to the nation. We have a young population. If we engage them appropriately in the agricultural sector, there is hope. Now, we are also struggling with the issue of youth employment. If we develop the agricultural sector in such a way that it can create job opportunities for the youth, it will work for the benefit of Africa. And then lastly, our import bill is so high. What does that mean? It means, therefore, that we are exporting our jobs to other parts of the world where we import food commodities from. And yet some of these things can be processed or can be produced and processed locally to meet the taste of the middle-income group, even for all categories of markets can be met with such a production. And then we should also now start thinking of putting Africa first when it comes to trading. There is enormous potential with different African economies growing in the excess of 5%. And such examples are found in Cote d'Ivoire, Ethiopia, Senegal, Rwanda, Morocco, and even Kenya. And not too long ago, in 2015, studies showed that Africa had 10 of the fastest growing countries in the entire world. But it also means that we need to now start thinking critically, how do we produce for high-end market? We need to industrialize, we need to mechanize, we need policies that work for Africa. Therefore, Africa's key task is to promote robust and labor-intensive industries for employment generation and efficient use of the continent's diverse resources. Africa's industrialization should target markets in Africa through the continental free trade area and also beyond through fairer trade agreements. Through fairer trade agreements. We also have the SPS agreement that we need to become aware of how to work around it to meet all the international trade requirements. So in a nutshell, that is what I would say the vision of Africa, the African Union is with regard to agricultural trade. We want to have one common market. And as I end, I want to share with you a quote from Kenya's president, His Excellency Uhuru Kenyatta, who said that there should not be a reason why Africa should trade with the rest of the world are not with itself. And also UNCTAD documented that CFTA is a critical, it's critical not only because of its potential benefits, but it's because it will mitigate the cost associated with inaction. With inaction of not being ambitious as Africa, with inaction of not taking advantage of the resources we have in Africa and the harnessing the potential that we have. I wish to thank you, and again, I wish you fruitful discussion and deliberations in this meeting. Thank you.